2 o'clock, according to the clock on the wall, so we shall start punctually. If I can invite and welcome indeed everyone to today's Transport Committee. And it says on my notes, and it's a very important sort of point, that when we are speaking during the meeting, we make sure that we all use the microphones so everyone can hear accordingly all the contributions that are being made. First item is apologies for that. I'm going to ask Colin just to give those.
Apologies, Councillor Creel.
Councillor Flatley as well. Isn't very well, so we can send our best wishes for a speedy recovery as well. Other than that, I think we look like we're all present, correct? Second item is declaration of interest, so that's it for me just to remind people, but Steve.
Yeah, Chair, in my role as scrutiny member on the will, we are discussing the notice of motion from Council, which refers to one of the stations in the report on item four. So it's a non-prejudicial interest. I can discuss this matter with an open mind, as I will at the scrutiny committee, but I think it's worth mentioning it has.
Lovely, thanks very much for that, Steve. And obviously, anyone else who's got anything to declare, either now or at any point during the meeting, please just indicate. Third item is the minutes of the last meeting, and can I move the minutes of the meeting that we held on the 5th of October approved as a correct record. On your chair's note, there is a reasonably sort of lengthy description of an answer that was given to Councillor Abbey about a question he asked. I'm not going to read it all out, but if we can take that as read, and can we agree those minutes is a correct record? Excellent. And into a very, very significant report now, because item four is the updated long-term rail strategy, and Wayne's going to present this one for us.
Thank you, Chair, and good afternoon. The long-term rail strategy that was originally produced in 2014 was an attempt to provide a framework to understand what was quite a significant number of documents that were setting out priority, particularly rail. Across what was the mayor's travel at that particular time before the advent of the city region. Some 28 or 29 documents in total contained all kinds of different priorities and objectives in relation to rail, so the intention was to try to put them into a single place and to package them in such a way as so as to make sense. So that was the kind of the gestation of the regional long-term rail strategy 2 years ago. It was always intended that the long-term rail strategy would be reviewed every couple of years or so. So we've done that this time around, and we've done that in-house using our own resources. So David Jones, who was the lead bank development manager, is here with me today, and Suzanne Kane, the more policy team, will have that review. In terms of the purpose of the document itself, it was to provide really a context and a prioritisation for the objectives of the city region. What we now need to do is to, as part of the review, look at the future challenges. So we look at things like, for example, consider the opportunity presented by HS2, the formation of the new bodies in rail and transport for North, but also the opportunity because of the devolution deal and the formation of the environmental policy is to look at the way in which rail priorities can be aligned to the wider economic priorities. The document itself firstly considers the work that's been achieved since the original document was produced, so a number of key projects have been taken forward, so the development of the rolling stock programme and infrastructure schemes such as those in Newcastle, Hartlepool and Middle North. It also looks at the change in environment, because we're now operating in quite a different environment, a different context to what the original report was considered within. And also this change in the funding structure as a consequence of the devolution deal, the role of the mayor and the combined authority, and the update of the economic environment in relation to that as part of considering scheme priorities. What we've done as well is we've restructured the packages, so the original 12 packages that are referred to within the paper were put together really to try to provide a framework to provide understanding. What we're now trying to do is to consider what the priorities were and what the immediate issues are that can arise and the consequences for that. So Liverpool Central Station, going back to 2009 as part of the Network Rail, Street revitalisation strategy identified that Liverpool Central Station was coming close to its capacity. But similarly, recent work through the City Rail study work has been done by Network Rail and also by ourselves. That's identified that continues to be the case. So capacity of Liverpool Central Station becomes the number one constraint on the network and number one priority, I suspect. So what we've tried to do is to consider the implications of all of the schemes identified in the strategy in the context of their impact on Liverpool Central Station. The long-term rail strategy now becomes a combined authority document, and hence the reason why we bring it to the Transport Committee to give views to members. But also it will go forward to the combined authority as well for their endorsement. I want to touch upon the schemes we've been taking forward so far. So they are basically a new rolling stock, so I'm sure members are aware that Saddle have now been appointed to the new trains. Work started on the development of the new depot. And at the start of October, Saddle took over the business transfer arrangement, whereby they now manage the maintenance of the existing rolling stock for 507 and 508. Design is due to be completed in 2018, with new trains coming onto the railway infrastructure in 2019 and 2020. We have a scheme at Newton Lowe's, which is putting in a new bus interchange, complete refurbished station, which is made fully accessible, and a car park which is available for cars. Importantly, that work is being done so it matches the changes under the new operating franchises for Northern and TVE and the increased capacity they will deliver. So the station infrastructure is being made ready for when that growth comes, and also to act as a key interchange for the city regions. We started on site with relation to a new station at Bull North, which is another fully accessible station with a 150 space car park. It's now on site. Intention is for that to be complete by May 2018. And again, that's been linked to economic growth within the city region, so the development of new housing within Seven Blair. Development of around about 1,500 new houses, so this station accommodates not only as a kind of a more general station on network, but also to provide capacity as a consequence of the new housing. Onco started on site as well, and this is a piece of rail infrastructure that connects the West Cheshire line between Carlsbury and Frodsham onto the West Coast Main Line at Halton. With the intention of being allowed to operate services along the West Cheshire Line from Chester and into North Wales and potentially South Wales in the future. There is an issue still to be resolved in relation to franchise letting for the services to operate on that, with the first services to operate between Liverpool and Chester. That work is due to be completed in around about May 2018, but the new service will operate around about December 2018. Discussions are ongoing with Transport for Wales in relation to the new Wales and Borders franchise to get agreement in relation to operating the service on that franchise. What is quite important in relation to long-term rail strategy is the fact that the environment in which the strategy is developed has changed quite considerably. So we've had, for example, the devolution deal. That really allows the city region to provide a greater input and direction in relation to rail priorities. There is a developing relationship with Transport for North and Rail North, with Transport for North due to become statutory body fairly shortly, and new franchises that come along. So we've already had the commencement of the Northern Transparent franchises, or East Midlands franchise, and the West Coast Refresh franchise. They're all franchises which are coming up for renewal, as well as the Wales and Borders franchise that we mentioned already. Development for HS2 continues along with the West East proposals in relation to what's been described as the Northern Powerhouse Rail Network under TMN. We have been quite explicit in relation to our desire to improve the offer from HS2 between Liverpool and London particularly, so that's part of that consideration. We've had some very positive news fairly recently in relation to developments for Northern Powerhouse Rail in two ways, really. One of which is the decision that was taken by Transport for the North Partnership that would endorse the development of new line capability between Liverpool and Manchester as part of Northern Powerhouse Rail proposals. But also the announcement by the Secretary of State for Transport in providing £300 million worth of budgets to develop what's called passive provision onto the HS2 Phase 2B network. supervision effectively means to provide the ability to make connections between various Northern Powerhouse rail connections onto the HS2 network at some future point in time and cause minimum disruption to the operation of that network post its completion. The hybrid bill for Phase 2B is due to be deposited in autumn 2019, and what we have been targeting for quite some time now is to get the inclusion of this hazard provision within that hybrid bill. So there's still work to be done in relation to development. The funding has been released by the Secretary of State with our HS2 to continue with the development of the consideration of options for those hazard provision. And we will continue with the development of options for the new line, and also the development of the business case and understanding the actual infrastructure solutions that might have to be adopted. Network rail during the period of time has been subject to a considerable number of scrutiny. A number of reviews have taken place of their operations and activities, particularly in relation to the way in which they plan and deliver and contract infrastructure enhancements. That led to the Hendy report that effectively put a stop on the development of major enhancement schemes, including a number of key electrification schemes across across the network. And also, for our part, had an impact in relation to any development funding that was due to be released in relation to CP6, the next control period, was also quite cold as well. Network Rail also going through some significant reorganisation as a consequence of some of those reviews. We had pressed at the time to have a northern route in relation to Network Rail. That wasn't the decision that was taken forward by government. And so what has been put in place is Network Rail will be set up as a series of independent operating entities as routes, somewhat akin to perhaps what would have been the old regional railways type structure in essence, but instead of it being a kind of sort of a complete single till in relation to their funding and into their performance metrics, each route will have its own parcel of funding and its own package of performance metrics that will be extremely visible to everybody, which they'll have to report on, which they'll regulate against, and also the formation of a body called the system operator, which will take over the centralised functions of Network Rail in relation to the wider national network type issues, such as, for example, strategic planning. You can imagine the circumstances of the rise of every route was allowed to plan its own timetable, for example, so that type of activity will be done centrally. We've updated the evidence base and consistent with new economic data and also taking into consideration economic development across the wider city region and the advent of the Strategic Investment Fund. The change to the packages, so from the original 12 packages that were in the study, we've now looked at the significance of Liverpool Central and the capacity constraints that will exist. Any schemes that we undertake on the network that go through Liverpool Central, bear in mind there's something in the region about 60% of the journeys on the network and run through Liverpool Central Station either on the Northern or the Rural Line network. So what we need to understand is what impact those any new schemes will have upon that capacity issues, the capacity challenge that we know is upcoming. So we've split the packages into effectively packages which we know are being delivered or are committed, packages which have an impact upon Liverpool Central Station directly and could generate further capacity issues, or projects which have a limited impact upon Liverpool Central Station, and that could be things which have sort of development of long distance capability or connectivity, perhaps connecting more of the Lime Street Station, for example, or other city region stations. Some of the big challenges we've got, there has been a change to the funding environment in relation to the way in which Network Rail regulated. As part of the regulatory control process, there are two key documents that are released by government. The next control period starts in CP6, which is in 2019. Ordinarily, what would happen is government would release two documents, the high-level output statement that says these are the range of things we want to buy from Network Rail in the next 5 years. And then it would also release something called SOFA, which is a statement of funds available, which is this is how much we'd like to pay for those things. That hasn't happened this year, so we're 2 years away from the start of the new regulatory control period. The HLOS statement was released in sort of June time, and largely focused upon operating and maintaining the renewal network. There were very limited references to enhancements. Subsequent to that, only a week or two ago, the SOFA intercept was once available, has been released by government as well, which gives perhaps a bit more insight into what they expect that money to be spent on. And so we've we need to spend a bit more time just understanding the implications of the city region, but largely it's focused again upon spending on operations maintenance renewal. The way in which enhancements will be paid for in the future is different as well. So previously you largely had to get something into that control period planning process to, especially the major schemes, to get recognition for funding. What will happen in the future is that every scheme can be presented to government as it arises from due development and for consideration, and subject to the scrutiny of its business case and its funding potential at that particular point in time without being constrained by those 5-year planning cycles. As far as we're concerned, the key issues are effectively funding for, but also the development and the gestation period for rail projects. Rail projects take a long time to get off the ground. They have to follow set processes and some challenging business case requirements from central government, as well as part of the SIP process for the city region going forward. Key development areas that we've identified through the long-term rail strategy is the consent I've already alluded to. We need to recognise development areas within the city region, so economic regeneration areas, so just one or two headlines there in terms of development of the Norwich Quarter and the Baltic Quarter. Lots of other development activity in the districts. Scamlesdale and Headwall Lane, Scamlesdale, a new station of rail link through led by Lancashire County Council. And we are contributing towards the development of that study and also looking at funding that study work and expanding the rail network between Kirby and Headwall Lane, the new station of Headwall Lane. Key also is improvement in terms of access and accessibility improvements linked to growth and the new rolling stock. The business case for the new rolling stock is founded upon growth, both underlying demand but also demand that's generated by the provision of an enhanced service proposition. We need to ensure that the railway infrastructure is capable of accommodating that growth. We need to make sure that stations are capable of allowing people to get on and off the rail network and also facilitating that growth in those areas to ensure that the rolling stock business case can be met. And obviously probably the most obvious one to most is also the consideration of new stations as well. So I guess in summary, the original long-term rail strategy gave us a starting point that we've made reference to. An awful lot has been achieved in the 2.5 years or so since that strategy was published. There has been some significant change in the environment with regards to the advent of the city region and the Vale Combined Authority, devolution, regulatory changes and funding challenges in the advent of Vale North, transport from North, and the progress of HS2, trying to take all those things into account. And the purpose of the long-term rail strategy is to provide a documented basis to allow discussion within the city region and to seek a consensus on what those priorities should be and what funding should be targeted for. Thank you.
Thanks for that, Wayne. I'm sure lots of questions and comments. We've certainly got Terry and Ron first. Steve, Mary, any others? Got it. We'll start with Tony and Ron. Keep your hands up and I'll note down a couple.
Thanks, thanks, Wayne. One of the big proposals for the future of the city region and how we move forward is the, obviously, the Port of Liverpool and the development within the Port of Liverpool and the amount of freight that's going to be moving from the Port of Liverpool, obviously, to various hubs throughout the country, because it's moving from a regional hub to a national hub, so it needs to tie into the national rail network. And the idea about HS2, the selling point for the government was not the timing, it was to free up the West Coast Main Line to allow more freight to move about the country. And in the following report, so that's HS2 plans for crew need to make sure that this does not hinder the growth of freight traffic, especially intermodal freight traffic to and from the Port of Liverpool, which has strong potential. Now that's Measure Travel's response to the HS2. So obviously it is a priority, but I don't know how far up the priority field that would be to ensure that we improve freight movements from the dock and therefore improve the economic benefits that come with it.
Yeah, thanks for that. You're absolutely right. It is a key priority. There are a number of things that you just touched upon. I know we've got a paper on the agenda in relation to the consultation response to the HS2 and accrual proposal, so perhaps not try to speak too much about that. In relation to HS2 development, generally speaking, and as part of the Northern Powerhouse Rail connectivity discussions that we're having with DfT and TfN, we're pressing quite strongly for new line connectivity between Liverpool and Manchester. There are other options that have to be considered, because that's the way in which you develop infrastructure to make sure you're developing best use of public funds and also value for money, and there's a strong business case for those options. For us, though, a new line will release capacity on the existing network that will help us with regards to the provision of freight. We're going to be involved in conversations in relation to the development of the Transpennine route upgrade, because irrespective of getting goods out of the ports and Liverpool onto the wider rail network, we have to make sure that the rest of the wider network can accommodate them. So we're also interested in what's being proposed in relation to West Coast mainline franchise submissions as well. So that's a key part of our discussions. It isn't just about the infrastructure solution for all the powerhouse rail, it's what the benefits the city region will bring. We have some challenges there, because what we see by priority isn't necessarily being seen as priority elsewhere, so we need to make sure we argue the case for that. In relation to dialogues that we're having outside of this, there have been meetings at very senior level with the Department of Transport, most recently which was with the Director General for the DfT, led by Frank Rogers, Chief Executive. And we had an opportunity to present to the Chief Executive, Director General of the DfT, and a number of other senior representatives of a number of priorities for the city region, and one of those key priorities was freight and access to and from port. One thing that we do need to deal with is access on and off the port in relation to handling rail freight. The rail freight capability on the port as they stand presently are quite limited, so we need to make sure that whilst we can fix attempt to fix the issue with regards to the wide rail network capacities, we also have to fix the capability of the port itself. Yes, thank you. A couple of points, I suppose, from the budget has been made. Absolutely correct again. We have been helping with DfT and with Network Rail for some considerable number of years now in relation to the need to develop the infrastructure capability on the Merseyside network particularly. What the new rolling stock does for us is it gives us capacity for some considerable number of years now that avoids the need for major rail infrastructure interventions to provide that capacity. So in effect what we're doing is providing capacity on the trains instead of having similar sized trains but having more railways to run on. So that's really significant for us. So that helps us think we're taking forward arguments for other enhancements that we might want to pursue with central government, particularly Network Rail. What it won't do is it won't deal with the fact that growth will come. and what we need to do is make sure that the future rail infrastructure and our stations and things like Park and Ride facilities are capable of accommodating that growth as well. So that's part and parcel of the consideration within long-term rail strategy. I touched very briefly upon the Bicton Wrexham comment. The new rolling stock, as well as being capable of running under conventional third rail electric traction, will have capabilities of an overhead line electric traction. But we're also considering within the rolling stock program the development of independent electric motor power. That's batteries, basically. So hybrid power has been much in the press fairly recently, with some of the decisions that were taken by the Secretary of State in relation to cancellation of electrification schemes. The bill to electrify between Bicton and Wrexham is likely to be quite substantial if that was adopted, so we do need to be considering the alternatives, and that's part of the reason why we're considering that as a way forward as well.
I think adding to that as well, it's also worth mentioning that collectively as an organisation in our involvement through North Wales Merseydeen Rail Task Force, we've been lobbying very, very hard for improvements to the next Welsh franchise. Hopefully that franchise will be announced in December, and one of the things we are hoping to see as part of that is a significant improvement of services on the Bicton and Wrexham line. So there's still a lot that we're doing to kind of keep lobbying the bidders, to lobby UK government and Welsh government, and working with all our partners here in the city region, in Cheshire and in North Wales. But we are hopeful that we'll be able to get a short-term step change and improvement on that line as well. Lots of people have put hands up, so next up we've got Harry, Pam and then Steve, and then there's some more people as well. So Harry.
Thanks, well, I just firstly want to reiterate what Councillor Abbey said, that the excellence of the reports. We get used to excellent reports here, sometimes we therefore forget to mention that fact. The only points I want to make are from a kind of local knowledge point of view, small points which, because of where I live, they come out to me. On page 72, there's a reference to Beechwood Station. So as the two Beechwood Stations referred to in the document, it needs to be clear which one it is, and it's the same on page 79. They are two references to Beechwood Station, which don't clarify whether they were or in wrong call. All of the references to Beechwood Station do clarify. The second is on page 58, the 6.24, the electrification of the Chester Shrewsbury and Chester Warrington lines. It stays while outside of the city region. Now, it's true that the vast majority it is, but one section, Runcorn East Station, of course, is in the city region, and it's important that it's important that we councils in Runcorn don't get people telling us that we've been moved. The third point is on page 34. At 3.3, and Chair, what I'm proposing is additional wording. The wording of the second sentence says, in particular, the local city region will be pressing for an increase in services between Liverpool and London for 2 trains an hour. Just for clarification, I'm proposing in particular, the Liverpool city region will be pressing for an increase in services between Liverpool and London. I'm just saying this comma, calling this whole it's road horn comma to trains.
Coming back on that, or just have a bit of acknowledge.
No, sorry, Chair, I'll think of that later on. Thank you.
Next we've got Pam, and then Steve and Mary.
Obviously a lot of work gone into that really, do appreciate that. I just wanted to get some clarification really when you talk about access and accessibility. I'm hopeful that does mean that it's accessible for disabled people. But I think it would just really be, it needs to be strengthened really to make sure that that's clear to everybody. Because for a lot of people, they don't realise that that's what it is. And it could be passed on to other people down the line somewhere who just just overlook the requirements of, people. Because in the actual report, it says accessibility, under the equality section, it says it's not addressed, when I think it probably is, but it's not specified. And that's an example of how it's overlooked. So if it's made clear, I guess that's what you do mean, if you confirm that's what you do mean, and that if you can do that in the report to make sure that the strategy, so it's quite clear what's meant.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, absolutely, I'm concurred with what's been said. The accessibility was intended to mean in the sense of accessibility, particularly for disabled persons. It is something which is public priority. We take the examples of the Rolling Stock programme, which accessibility has been one of the primary drivers for the Rolling Stock design, and also the work taking place in relation to the platform chain interface for the Rolling Stock programme. In addition to that, the work that we're doing at McGull and the work that we're doing at Newton Burrows will bring full accessibility to those locations. And the work that was done fairly recently in the North are good examples of where that's been definitely a primary concern. Take on board the comment that perhaps it's not as explicit as it needs to be, and we'll look forward to enhance that wording.
Got Steve and Mary then, Tom.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Mine's about the table on page 73. I have mentioned this at a previous meeting. There's some ambiguity between where you describe something as a short-term scheme and a long-term scheme. Well, the only reference I can see to short and long-term is on page 61, which is a timeline. So in one column you're saying these schemes perform less well, which means they haven't performed well, but are achievable in the short term. So they're both one sort of laughing at the other. If when the final report is written, there's some clarification around what these phraseologies mean in terms of achievability, I think it'll make the document better for everyone. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, we'll certainly look to provide that clarity. For the purposes of the committee, just to make it perhaps a bit clearer for now, subject to the report being amended, what we had developed was a station assessment tool. So we had something in the region, I think, about 24 stations in the region long-term rail strategy. Over time, we have a number of members, a number of other stakeholders who expressed interest in developing stations. So what we wanted to do is to produce a tool that would provide advice to funders about which stations were more likely to be able to deliver a sustainable business case and provide a case for funding. So we developed a station assessment tool, which is a multivariable, which has a number of multivariable criteria. Like, so for example, it will have demand levels, it will have constructability, it will have connectability in terms of rail networks, that type of thing, all those different variables to be assessed. And then each of the stations has been assessed according to that criteria to give us some sort of feel for it. The terms short-term and long-term need some better clarification about the sound of things, because short-term effectively schemes that are standalone station schemes that could be implemented on the railway network today. Longer-term schemes are schemes which need to have some other infrastructure development for them to be able to be constructed. So stations at Skelmersdale, Liverpool John Lennon Airport, for example, they're good examples of where people have a desire to have stations constructed, but there isn't any railway joining them at the moment. So they are kind of more longer-term. A longer term isn't necessarily meant to indicate that it's necessarily a gestation period, other than the fact that obviously great infrastructure will take longer to develop and be funded, but more about just kind of sort of trying to differentiate between the ease at which those two things could be done.
I think it's probably also important to wrap as well that we will bring back a future report specifically around sort of new stations and prioritisation around those, either at the next meeting or the meeting after that. Quite soon we'll get that report coming through. Mary.
Yeah, thanks for the updated report. Can I ask a question, and I'll be parochial here, and I apologise to anyone that thinks I'm being too parochial, but when we talk about new stations, growing numbers using the new stock when we do get it, we have huge issues in South Liverpool with South Parkway, with the growing number of people parking on the roads in the three wards surrounding the station. The car parking facilities are nowhere near enough, and I would expect within 5 or 10 years we need to address this. Now, is this partly addressed in this document? Is it hidden in some way?
I think the whole issue of Park and Ride is mentioned in the documents, and it is intended that is a cross council sort of network issue, if you will. We see the provision of Park and Ride facilities as being one of the primary priorities that we need to pursue in terms of development of the long term rail strategy. And one of the key issues in relation to that is the acquisition of land, so we need to be clear about where land parcels come up that are suitable and affordable, for which enhancements could be undertaken. Our aim is to come back to committee at future times with proposals in relation to specific part of land facilities, but I'll give you one example where we're looking to acquire land at Spittle, for example, where land has become available and is affordable. It makes sense, given the challenge that we're going to have both in terms of the underlying growth on the ground level, but also that which has to be catered for because of the new rolling stock. But we start to think about the ways in which we get people on and off the rail network. Park and Ride is a really important part of that, not least of which is we have to consider about the things I've just said about the facilitating and enabling growth, but also about encouraging people to make better use of public transport and car parks and getting people to and from stations. Is one of the primary ways to get people on and off the rail network to get them into the other parts of the city region. So we see that that's a big issue. We will be coming back at some future point in time to be determined. We've just started a piece of work looking at the Park and Ride strategy, which builds upon the previous work that they've done, the previous policy side that's in place, and making some propositions in relation to what we'd like to recommend.
Tom?
Thanks, Wayne. I'm also referring to Appendix 3 about the new stations. And I see that St James Station and Smithdown Road both performed well and potentially short-term projects. Both projects I'd love to see come to fruition. As a result of this assessment of them as performing well, is there likely to be any sort of work in the very near future to start trying to cost up those plans? And one other point as well, referring back to rail freight and port. I think one of the issues facing getting freight out by rail is the fact that it's constantly undercut by the fact that roads are free for HGVs, so there's a kind of incentive for the companies to use the roads. And I just wonder if we could encourage more freight onto rail if we had some kind of road pricing system which charged HGVs to use the road so that rail is constantly getting undercut.
I'll just respond on the new stations bit. So we have done some further work on St James. It involves common station assessment work, and we will be bringing a report at the same time as we bring the station assessment report about how we're doing station assessments. We will bring something up on St James to give you some understanding about how well it will perform, level of usage, sort of the amount of work that's been done. What I would say though is any further development work, one of the key things will be is funding to carry out that development work. And that's one of the issues that's under discussion at the moment. Because it isn't cheap to do these pieces of work. And you can't guarantee in the long term that you'll actually deliver something. But that is something that the regulated part of the budgetary process.
Sorry, just to pick up
on
that, I won't try to answer the question in relation to
rail
charging. In relation to development, also we've got the book with regards to development funding, because this is quite a key challenge for us. Now we've got a number of schemes which are being constructed and delivered, a significant part of our next workload over the next kind of sort of 12 months to 2 years is about development of schemes, and there is a challenge in relation to funding for development. I think I mentioned earlier on in the description of long-term rail strategy that as a consequence of the Henry report, development funding that would have been available for certain schemes ahead of CP6 was curtailed. So that limits a lot of opportunity in that respect. But also the fact that you classify early scheme development funding as revenue, not as capital. So we're in a situation where there's a potential for avenues for us to secure capital funding, but revenue funding, as is elsewhere, is under some significant challenge. So we have to highlight the fact that if we look at the council of compliance programme that we have at the moment, based upon the assessment of priorities, obviously to be informed by the transport committee as well, that we could be getting into sort of £3 million, £6 million for the next 2 years, including development work in Liverpool Central Station, that we have to deal with this sort of that in relation to funding. So I thought just worthwhile just typing that to the Chris.
Can I just respond and say I think low pricing goods vehicles is a great idea.
Okay, thanks for that, Dave. Well, let me just flip that round the other way, then, to give a different sort of view on kind of pricing. Actually, if you're shifting goods and freight for long distance, over 100 miles, it's actually cheaper to do it by train, because in very blunt terms, you only need one train driver instead of rather than 20 or 30 truck drivers. The key to making sure that rail freight is competitive and actually a better proposition is to make sure the capacity is there so it's available to move, because business in the haulage industry will just go by whatever's the cheapest way of shipping. So fundamentally, to actually get as much stuff on the rail network and off the road, we've got to have the rail capacity. What that means for the Port of Liverpool is particularly long distance rail capacity, which crucially means why we need a new brand new high speed link into the city so we can free up capacity on the conventional network to move goods and freight. So that's the way to actually get more stuff on the rail rather than charging trucks on the roads. That's just, again, my personal view, slightly different to where Dave. I've got Ken, then Alan, then Natalie and Patrick as well.
Thanks, Chairman. And again, can I commend your team, Wayne, for the excellent, superb report, taking a long, long time to do. I think this also, this report, puts us at the front of the queue, because for the transport for the north, the government threw a bat at us for us to put a plan in for HS3. The point is, we all want the thing to start from Liverpool, and Liverpool to be the number one. So now with our long-term strategy in place, hopefully the rest then can follow on from us and take note from what we're doing. Going back to a couple of things on the freight, of course, it's been said many, many years, move more freight onto rail. Well, as the containers, which are going to start to come in more and more into Liverpool, each of those containers will have a customer. Now, lots of those customers don't sit on the end of rail tracks. You know, they could be going to a business park, to a retail park, to whatever. So what we would be looking at is moving from the dock into a large marshalling area somewhere to get that free, so that'll be to and fro. So that's one thing. The other thing about charging for road usage, it's a couple of £1,000 for a heavy goods vehicle. Now, if all the money that was collected on road tax, as it used to be, was put into the roads, we'd have a better road system. So it's being well paid for by the people that use it. Don't forget, it was Churchill who sort of took that road tax away during the war to help for the war effort, and it's never been reinstated. So, you know, you look at heavy goods vehicles, average of about 7 miles to the gallon. Look at the duty on that, the duty, so I think they're well paying for what they do. So the other thing is, it's finding a good marshalling yard, so it's to and fro from there. And again, you mentioned, Wayne, about bids for the new process, the way they've set up the rail the rail structure. I know we're usually in front of the game of getting our bids together and having them on the shelf for when the government says, can we have a bid, and then we can put ours in. So I hope we've got the wherewithal and the staff to be able to do that, to sort of be one step ahead of the government, so as when they ask for bids, we've got one on the shelf, or more than one on the shelf, to do that. Going back to Mary's point as well, about parking, Hyden Station has just been upgraded, four track,